Hello, I'm Kumi Taguchi. We're looking back at some past episodes during COVID, which I hope we can all bounce back from before too long. In tonight's show, my colleague Janice Peterson asked the question, how do you rebound from failure?
Every single day I'd be like, what if I fail, what if I fail?
So what happened in the end?
It was game over when the ATO froze my bank account.
I felt like I'd failed my family badly. We actually sat together on the gutter and all cried together.
I was also living at home at the time, so I put on my suit and I just pretended to keep working for 6 months.
We should actually be celebrating failure.
Hello and welcome everyone. Naji, let's start with you. Not too long ago, you had a string of restaurants called Miss Chu. How did you discover things were going south and about to collapse?
Well, I was in Japan actually, speaking to some potential investors when a phone call came to me from my general manager saying that I think you're going to be insolvent within a matter of 2 or 3 weeks. And I nearly died.
It would have been not possible.
It's
a huge shock.
It was a huge shock. It was big. You know, like it felt surreal and I thought he was actually joking. I was waiting for the punchline, you know, and it didn't come. Yeah.
Did you feel that up until that point you'd had a successful business?
Well, I had 8 stores. I had 9, really. One in London, with a turnover of 25 million within 7 years. So that was quite successful. You know, like, it was... My plan was, do you want to eat McDonald's or do you want to eat Miss Chu? You know, I mean, I dared to dare that. I dared to dream big. I never wanted to be as big as McDonald's, but I thought... You know, like, what if you get to a point where you've got a critical mass and you've been able to influence the world to eat fast and better, and also put a refugee voice onto the global map through my brand?
That all sounds incredibly positive. So why do you think it collapsed?
Well, you know, like, a series of things. Like, why do you have a car accident? You don't plan on having a car accident. You don't plan on getting cancer. So, you know, like, every single day I'd be like, what if I fail? What if I fail? And so I was literally in the process of setting up infrastructure and restructuring the company against failure.
And yet you seemed quite shocked that it was falling apart. How come you weren't aware of that a bit earlier?
Wasn't supposed to happen. Had I put in the infrastructure in earlier, it wouldn't have happened. I ran out of... The ATO didn't give me enough time to negotiate with them. I mean, look, there are things I can't say because of litigation.
Sure.
There were, you know, like... I mean, people say, delegate, 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 and that's exactly what I did. I did exactly what a business owner and an entrepreneur with a... small to medium-sized business does, which was delegate and trust. And unfortunately, that's where I went wrong.
So,
and it's all my fault, of course. I don't blame anyone other than myself.
How did you try to save it?
Well, I was on the phone to everyone I could. I was on the phone to people with money. I was on the phone to entrepreneurs. What do? I was on the phone to lawyers. So, I mean, I was in shock and... it was game over when the ATO froze my bank account because, for me, I was like, we were still paying staff, we were still paying suppliers, we were still trading.
Well, so, how much was frozen?
I mean, well, 500,000.
How did that make you feel?
Oh, I had no power left. I was had lost everything.
Dan, welcome back to Insight. You've been here before. Let's take a look.
My name's Dan McLaughlin, and I'm trying to become a professional golfer. I started golfing when I was 30 years old, and I decided to quit my job and dedicate my life to attempting to become a professional golfer by practicing for 10,000 hours. What I wanted to do is basically take something I had absolutely no experience in and see how far you can go. And not see how far you can go as a, you know, a 5 to 20-year-old, but to, as an adult, to see if you can really succeed in a brand new field.
Oh.
So there you are, Dan. You're 30 years old, you've had no prior experience, but you've thought, you know what? I'm going to give professional golfing a red hot go. Did you really think you were going to pull this off?
I thought 100%. I never had a doubt that I could make it.
So what happened in the end?
So I made it 5 years, 6,000 hours, and I was playing a tournament and my back had been aching and it got worse throughout the day and it was a 3-day event. The next day it kind of got a little worse, and by the end of the third day I took a swing and just fell down and I couldn't bend over, walk up and down stairs, or pretty much do anything for 6 months without pain.
And what do you think caused the injury then?
I think a little bit of overuse, probably. I'd say like obsessing and just doing way too much of one thing over and over.
The human body's probably not meant to play that amount of golf every single day, only when you turn 30, right?
Yeah, I had a good physical therapy workout and routine going for at least the first 4 years, and then I started doing less of the preventative aspects and more of just swinging. And so it's just one side and the repetition. So I think I slowly went from an all incorporated kind of healthy pursuit of it to just going and just doing the actual game itself.
So how much of your life did you put into this pursuit?
Well, I started when I was 30, quit my job. So, I mean, that, you know, I put that career on the sideline. And I basically, I mean, it became my entire life. It became what I did as my career. It became what I did, what I thought about outside of, you know, quote unquote work. My social circle was all tied to golfing, outings and friends. And, you know, it got down to the point where, you know, for birthdays and Christmas, you just got golf balls and tees and like random like golf things that, you know, when I was 25, I never would have even imagined people would have thought of getting me as a present.
And how did you feel then in the end when you were forced to quit?
I think, yeah, you know, it's the stages of acceptance. For a long time, I was just in denial. I just kept thinking, okay, well, you know, when this gets better, when I get back at it. And, you know, time just kept going and going. And I was just always in this thought, in this mindset that, okay, I'm just going to pick it back up. And, you know, a month passed, and then 3 months passed, and 6 months passed. And then it basically took about 2 years to kind of realize that I wasn't going to continue that path. And I had to just accept the fact that I needed to move on and make a complete life change.
Jane, you had a setback in your career, but you dealt with it in a very unusual way. Tell us about that.
So I had, with my first business, I was originally working on it as a side business and working in corporate finance at Ernst & Young. And I actually quit my job to work on that business. And I was so excited. I was like, I'm going to make it. This is great. And a month later, that business failed. And so because my parents and I immigrated from China when I was 8, they kind of like, they sacrificed, you know, everything they had, their family, friends, their jobs, to move here with me. We came here, didn't speak a word of English, and, you know, they took up jobs as cleaners and working in factories so that they could give me more opportunities in life. And with that, they wanted me to have a secure job and financial security, which sure. I had. And so basically I threw that all away for this business, and then the business failed. So all of a sudden, previously I had been very academic throughout high school and uni. I already had this great job. I had everything that they could possibly have wanted, you know, for their immigrant daughter. I played 8th grade piano, like I was ticking all the boxes for them. And then all of a sudden I had nothing. And it was in the middle of the global financial crisis. I couldn't get another job again. I was in debt. So because I had no other options and Unfortunately, because I was also living at home at the time, I just pretended to go to work every day for 6 months. So I put on my suit and just like I just pretended to keep working for 6 months.
And how did that feel? How did that feel to do that?
It was a lot of fun. Thanks for asking. No, it was. A typical day for me would be getting up really early in the morning. And let me tell you, there's nothing worse than getting up early when you're not a morning person, when you are unemployed anyway. So I'd have to get up early, slap on my suit, have breakfast with my parents, and then my mom worked in the city, so I have to catch the bus into the city with her. I carried it around an empty laptop bag, and then I would go into the city. I've kind of did different things, but I started off by going to cafes, and then didn't want to even pay for like a fake coffee, so I went back to the state library, which is where I used to study back in high school. And then I got a part-time job as a receptionist. And, you know, I think because it was such a crappy situation, it really pushed me to try and do something else. And that's when I started my current business.
During that time, though, it really sounds like you were the antithesis of what you used to be. You were highly driven, you were motivated, and you achieved results. How do you think you got to that point?
Back then?
Mm.
Yeah, I think I'm, you know, growing up was very driven, but mainly also because I saw more of my parents sacrifice and I wanted to kind of repay them. I wanted them to be proud. I'm an only child as well, so I had all that kind of, I mean, they're pretty chilled for Asian parents, if I can say, but they're still, at the end of the day, like, I still felt that pressure, I guess. And so, you know, in high school, I got a 99 plus UAI. I went and studied the Bachelor of Commerce, which is what they wanted me to study and which is what I wanted to study. I got a corporate job lined up for me when I was still in high school. And so I was really kind of like really ahead of my career. And I thought I had it all. It was never even a consideration that I would lose it all. And I know that, you know, now with hindsight, of course, it's not as bad as it sounds. But at the time it was, you know, I thought I barely have corporate experience. It's the global financial crisis. How was I going to bounce back? Because, I couldn't just get another job and I didn't know about the entrepreneurial world. I already failed in it.
Well, that first business of yours went belly up very, very quickly. Explain to us what it was.
We ran pop-up stores in underutilised locations. So we thought, we saw that there's certain bars, especially in the CBD, that would be busy during the week at night and on weekends. So we thought that during the day, while they were empty, we could use that space and set up a pop-up store. So we would bring them traffic, and because it was a highly high traffic area, you know, it would be great for retail foot traffic. And we thought we would take this great new spin to the traditional retail business model. And then what I learned was there was probably a reason that people weren't already doing it, probably because that the business model doesn't work. But yeah, so we learned it the hard way, I guess.
And just tell us, how long was it before that failed?
So there was about 3 months of planning to set up the business, and then we did that for 6 months. And then one of my business partners told me that she didn't want to do it anymore. And I didn't have the confidence to be in business by myself. So when she said that we were going to fold the business, I knew that was it. Like, I begged her and begged. But when she, you know, put the foot down, I knew that was it.
And did you ever think you'd like to go back to a corporate job?
Oh, hell no. Can I say that?
So no. Things were bad, but they weren't that bad.
Yeah. Well, oh no, at the time, no, I would have done anything to have gotten my job back. But I wasn't that great at it. And I knew that my previous employers wouldn't take me back. And because of the global financial crisis, which at the time I was like, why? And now it's such a blessing in disguise, because I'm so glad that was never an option for me. And it kind of forced me into doing what I'm doing now.
Mal Leyland, you and your brother Mike had one of the most successful Australian TV shows of the 70s and 80s. Remember this?
Travel all over the countryside, ask the Leylands, ask the Leylands. Travel all over the countryside, ask the Leyland brothers. Whatever it is that you want to see, hasta Leyland, no matter whatever that happens to be, hasta Leyland, brother. Come on, me in it and join in the fun, travel all over Australia.
They don't make TV titles like they used to.
I miss the combi.
I bet you do. After the success of that show, you and your brother decided that you would start a theme park called Leyland Brothers World. Why was that?
That idea came out of the fact that we had visited just about every man-made tourist park in Australia and filmed it and saw how successful they were. But we also knew that television couldn't last forever. People have their day and then their history. Then we thought perhaps the idea would be better if we built our own place, learning from all the people that we'd met. And we got onto the people that we'd met at SeaWorld and so forth and got good ideas from them. They were very helpful. And it actually worked quite well, except for one problem. We didn't have enough money to build the entire thing without borrowing money. And we put in our own money, which was around about $6 million, and we borrowed another three, just over three. At the time we borrowed it, we thought the interest rates were ridiculous because they were 12%. That was horrific, we thought. But within 18 months, we were then paying 28%. That was horrific. And of course, we had to find about $2,000 a day just to pay the interest only. And we were managing it. We were turning over about $3.6 million a year, employing quite a lot of people. We had 60-odd people altogether. 62 people were working for us. And in the end, we missed one payment. And the bank, who shall remain nameless for the purposes of this program, 7 days later, took over the whole place and threw us out.
Gosh, it happened very quickly.
It was very quick. And although I don't feel badly about the fact... I feel badly about the way they did it, not so much that they had the right to do it, because we did miss one payment. We had no options but to accept the reality of the risk we'd taken. The risks didn't work out. But we'd taken a lot of risks in life prior to that. We'd crossed the Simpson Desert for the first time by vehicle back in 1966, and that was a risk to our lives as much as anything else. And we went from Darwin to Sydney in an 18-foot open boat, the longest open boat journey in the world at the time. They were risks, but they were calculated risks, and we took those risks. This was another calculated risk, and we took that. But it wasn't that that hurt us. It was being treated like we'd done something criminal, and that's how we were treated.
Can you remember exactly then when it was very evident that things were going to collapse?
It was obvious that it couldn't continue with the downturn. We put everything we had on the line. If I was to redo it, I would do it differently.
But it was more than just losing the theme park in the end, wasn't it? There was a bit more at stake.
Well, yes. We had everything we owned. It left us basically without anything at all. Lorraine had a house in her name, but there was a big loan on it. When we finally ended up selling it, we ended up with a total of about, was it
$7,000?
$7,000 is what we had left. Well, Lorraine had left, to be perfectly accurate about it. Yeah.
And you went in with $6 million?
Yes. Yeah, it was a bit of a shock. Takes a bit of adjusting.
Yeah, that's a big fall.
It is. We went to the markets, for example. We had no money, so we'd sell our clothes. We had stuff that was given to us as wedding presents, like cut glass and stuff like that. And our clothes, our shoes, we'd take them to the markets at Mount Gravatt in Queensland, and we'd turn up at 4 o'clock in the morning in the dark and set up a little stall and clean all this stuff up and sell it. And you'd get $2 for this and $3 for that. And then at the end of the day, we'd count up the money, or Lorraine did. She was cashier, you see. She used to handle all the money, still does. And she had added all up, and I say, we've got enough to fill the tank on the truck. She says, no, you can get half a tank of fuel. And that would have to last us the whole week. And next week, we'd be back again with another lot of stuff. I used to go up to this a fruit stall there. He used to sell his seconds, and I'd go up and I'd have $4 or $5 or $10 or whatever I could afford to buy. And one day I went up to him and I said, what have you got today? He said, oh, I've got a few. He said, how much have you got? I said, oh, I've got about $8. And he says, I want to say thank you to you, because he had a strong Italian accent, or it was Greek or something. I'm not quite sure, but it was a strong accent. And he said, you know, I used to watch your shows. I know who you are. I said, oh, really? He said, yes. He said, when we came to Australia, we used to watch your shows to learn all about our new country.
Ah, fantastic.
And I said, oh, well, that's interesting. He says, yeah. And he brought out this big bag of fruit and vegetables and gave them to me. And I gave him the money. I said, there's not enough money there. He said, that's okay. He says, you gave me much more than that. He says, and every week from then on, when I went to see him, he'd always give me much more than it was worth. And his encouragement and what he said, those sorts of people, they made us feel so good. They really gave us a boost.
So tell us then what that was like for you. How did that all feel?
I felt like I'd failed my family badly, and that hurt me more than anything else. And I remember this afternoon when we sat down on the side of the road with my daughter, who at the time wasn't very old, she was about 17, and we were just had to explain to her that we couldn't afford to buy some KFC. And she didn't understand. She didn't know. And we had to tell her why we were in this position. That was one of the hardest things. We actually sat together on the gutter and all cried together.
I was more afraid of regret than failure.
Exactly.
Like, this, to me, it's just doing it was what you needed to do,
yeah.
What I needed to do.
That's right.
Yeah, and you know, it's like...
The road not taken, right? I mean, for me, yeah. Nothing is scarier than still being an accountant.
And same, and nothing is scarier for me than being stuck in a bank.
Paul, you played more than 80 games for the Socceroos. You were captain for 6 years. And then you played a game against Canada in 1993. What happened next?
You know, I think I'd played about 88 games for the Socceroos without being dropped. I owed that pretty prestigious moment of being the only captain ever dropped from the national team, because the coach said, come here, you. I don't like your attitude. You're whinging and complaining about the training ground, and you're not the player I picked as the captain. You're dropped. Now, the first thing I did, and it might not appear to be a major life-changing moment in the big picture, but right then, right there, that was my life. I'd spent 7 years as a Socceroo to be told that.
What was that like for you?
It was humiliating. I was embarrassed. I prided myself on my attitude and my work ethic. So to be told that your attitude sucks and you're not playing for your country anymore, it's like, wow.
Ron, you're a sculptor. Cast your mind back to 1978. That's when you landed a huge commission to deliver a piece of art for a square, a new square for Melbourne. Just how much was at stake for you at that point?
Sort of everything. There was a bad reaction to the sculpture, which I did for everybody's pleasure. It was in the middle of a bluestone structure square, and it was a bright yellow sculpture. I was bringing a bit of warmth and light to the square and to Melbourne, because I come from Sydney. And then the reaction from very conservative power block in Melbourne accused me of frightening horses and turning small children blind. And so that came as a surprise to me when...
Are you the yellow peril man?
I'm the yellow peril.
Why is that a failure? It's the most amazing piece of art in Australia.
That's very...
That's not a failure. It still is the most amazing piece of art. It's just perception. It's what
the name was a little bit... That was the nickname, by the way.
The yellow peril.
The piece is actually called Vault. I just throw that out there? Yeah.
But its final launch place after three moves... was out in front of ACCA, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Melbourne. But I really... The pain... There was confusion.
Ron, you're trying to bring a bit of sunshine to Melbourne, and yet you're facing this chorus of criticism about your work, which had positive intentions. How did that make you feel?
Oh, a little confused. Particularly in the beginning, it was quite hurtful. And then in time, it... And there were also a reasonable amount of people who were very enthusiastic about it, so it wasn't black and white. It was a talking centre, and in a way, it brought great attention to me, so it really turned out to be very positive. And that the negative aspect of that in the early stages was painful, but in the end, it really became very positive.
Ron, even the Queen weighed into this. She said, reportedly, that the piece should be painted a more agreeable colour.
I'm not sure it was the Queen. It sounds something like Prince Philip would have said, actually, rather than the Queen.
Take that as a compliment.
I've been the brunt of some others, so of his, so yes, I'm used to that by now.
In any case, the council in the end decided it had to go.
3 a.m. Sunday morning may seem like a bit of an odd time for a removalist job, but such was the case for the dismantling and relocating of the Yellow Peril. At a cost to the city of $29,500, contractors moved into the city square under a veil of darkness early yesterday morning, trying to get the massive structure out before the media, unions and public turned up to see the operation. This morning, though, Melbourne woke up to these headlines. And so, after 2.5 years, the $70,000 Yellow Peril has finally ended up here in Muddy Batman Park.
So there it is, at Muddy Batman Park. How did that feel?
Not good. Now Batman Park is a sort of respectable place. Then it was reclaimed shunting yards near the railway. The sculpture was meant to be engaged with in a human level, regardless of its size. And Batman Park was isolating it. You saw it mostly from freeways, and that's not how I thought it should have been viewed. That was one of the more upsetting things.
Naji, how did other people react to the news that you were losing your business?
The trolleys came out, and then there were people, unfortunately, who were like, "Ah, serves it right," you know. So, unfortunately for me, I felt a little bit like, oh, here we go. Australia's actually now celebrating my failure.
It was very much in the public eye, wasn't it? You mentioned the papers had picked it up.
It was very much in the public eye.
And your identity, your name was attached to the business. Even your face was attached to the brand. And now the public is seeing the downfall of all of that. How did that affect you?
For me, I didn't want the public to see that a Vietnamese person and a Vietnamese entrepreneur and a Vietnamese refugee had failed. It wasn't about me. I wanted Australia to be proud of what I had created, which was Vietnamese food done well and fast, scalable, something that no one had done before. This is before Uber Eats, before Deliveroo. I was doing electric bike deliveries before everyone else did. I was packaging it up. I had an app before everyone else had an app. I was online. And Australia needed me. I actually really thought that. Australia needed a really good voice to just say, hey, look, you know, everyone just chill out. You ling, we bling. That's funny. Come on, you know. You told me to assimilate and I have, but I'll take it a bit further. And that's what I stood for.
So, Dan, you took a lot of people with you, didn't you, on your journey through your blog. What was it like having to tell them you'd had this major setback?
I mean, that was by far the hardest part. I mean, for me, I was just waiting and waiting to, you know, get better so I could go back on the journey. And people email, even this morning I wake up and I get an email from somebody like, you haven't blogged in 2 years, like what's going on? And you know, it's every day and you just feel like every day you're letting somebody down, because it did turn into, you know, this is my personal journey, but then it became kind of a group effort. And when I was injured or when I couldn't practice, I felt like it wasn't just me that was, you know, on the sidelines. It was this whole kind of just large group of people. So just not being able to have any positive updates, like not being able to write anything and no progress. And, you know, just I would try to write, but I'd be like, oh, you know, injured again. You know, there's still no updates. I still can't do anything. And people kept asking me to write more. Like, what are you doing? What's the injury like? And I just got to a point where I didn't know what to say. And I just couldn't update anything. And I'd have all these emails. And then actually they started turning really negative. And I was, you know, I felt bad and I didn't know what to do. But, you know, people started accusing me of like faking an injury. And I'm like, why would I, it's like there's no money on the line. Yeah, that was the hardest part, is just trying to not let down people who are going along on the ride.
So where did that leave you then?
So it was about a 2-year process of just kind of going through all of the emotions and understanding where I was in life and what I needed to do next.
For you, Naji, let's talk about the people you knew. How did they react to the demise of the business?
Shock, denial, how can it be? For some people, I think I found that some people started to disassociate themselves with me because they didn't want to be associated with failure. So I soon found out over the next 12 months and even like the next 2 years who my true friends were. And that was really interesting.
How about for you, Jane? What happened to the relationship with the friend who initially coaxed you into that first business?
So I think for the first year we didn't really talk, and then I think as my business grew and as she started landing back on her feet, getting back into the corporate world, we kind of rekindled our friendship, and I think it's like, kind of like all's fair in love and war and business when no one's actually done anything wrong. She didn't want to do it anymore, and that's fair. And for me to have convinced her to try and keep going with the business when she wasn't, her heart wasn't in it, you know. I mean, I'm actually so glad, because I would have just kept digging and kept going with it, and it's just the business model wouldn't have worked. So I'm so glad that she, at the time I felt like she screwed me over, but I'm so glad it happened.
Okay, you've come out the other side.
Yeah.
Mal, you of course enjoyed enormous success with the TV show. Did you find people treated you differently once the theme park had collapsed?
Yes. When you go broke, really broke, you know who your true friends are. I reckon if you go to your grave with one good friend, you've done all right in life. And I found out, I had a phone call from a bloke who I used to know very well. He worked in television as well, had his own business. And Barry rang up and he said, mate, I know you're having a rough time, but if you need a house to live in, I've got one. I've got an editing studio if you need anything, and if I've got the equipment, if you want to do anything, you're welcome here as long as you like. It was the only phone call I ever had like that from anybody. Other people who I thought were my friends suddenly no longer contacted us. Suddenly we had some sort of disease, so it seemed, and we were on our own. Luckily, the most important person in my life, Lorraine, stuck with me. Well, I wouldn't have blamed her if she hadn't. I think I might have died if that had happened. But the stresses that it brought to me manifested themselves in other ways. I ended up with a cancer out of it, on which the doctor has convinced was a result of the stress.
And do you believe that too?
I do.
Why risk failure?
Because life's a bit dull if you don't take a few risks. I mean, climbing up a tree when you're a child is a risk, but you do it because it's exciting and you want to prove something to yourself. Well, we've done the same thing throughout our lives. Everything we took on has had a risk attached to it. Most of the time we pull it off, and occasionally we didn't. That was a rather big crash for us, of course. And getting back on our feet again afterwards hasn't been easy. In fact, it's been quite difficult. But that's not what it's about. It's about the fact that you do get up and get on it.
I think we have something in common here, all of us. It's that we weren't afraid of failure. We were afraid of not doing something.
Yeah, well, Walt Disney.
I was petrified of not having done something with my life. So it wasn't actually the let's do something and what if it fails. That came after. It was more like, oh, my God, I haven't done anything. That was, for me, like, petrifying.
Well, Walt Disney went bankrupt several times before he made the success that he is. I mean, well, he's gone, but Mickey's still here.
I was more afraid of regret than failure.
Exactly.
Like, this, to me, it's just doing it was what you needed to do, what I needed to do.
That's right.
Yeah, and, you know, like...
The road not taken, right? I mean, for me, nothing is scarier than still being an accountant.
And same, and nothing is scarier for me than being stuck in a bank.
Paul Wade. And we'll take it.
That was my moment that I went, yes, Paul Wade is back to what he was.
So many people would say to me, oh, that's right, you've always been such a career girl, you just left your run a little bit too late.
He's going to absolutely waste my final fertile years, and I can't do that.
Well, I froze my eggs about 6 years ago now, and then it cost $10,000.
I just made the choice that not every woman was meant to be a mother.
Nati, after the collapse of Miss Chu, do you feel like you've bounced back or you're getting there?
Well, it's like death, you know. Do you ever get over it? It gets less and less painful. You know, I'm still healing, of course. Did I bounce back? Yes, I had to. I started a new restaurant very, very recently called Charlie Boy. It's a yum cha house. It's very different. You know, I did something very new again, something that no one had done, which was yum cha 7 days a week, day and night. It was a big risk. Will it work? I don't know. For me, I have bounced back because I have a life. It's less stressful. It's not as big as Miss Chu. I have much less income. So for me, that is my success. You know, that's for me. I have my life and my health and my acumen. And I'm a creative, and I now have the luxury of time to create. When I was Miss Chu, I didn't have that. I was always, like, stressing out. There were so many what-ifs, what if I fail? So it feels like a blessing in disguise a little bit that I now have a second chance at it. And I've grown a lot. I've learnt so much, you know. I've learnt to listen and learn, yeah.
You never stop learning.
You never stop learning.
You go to your grave and I think the very last thing you'll learn is what happens.
Yeah.
That's the last lesson.
Yeah. There's one thing I won't regret, though, that. I won't regret not having done it.
Mel, how about for you? Have you been able to recover after losing everything?
Financially or emotionally?
A bit of both.
Financially, we're nowhere near where we were, but that's not that important, I don't think. I think what is important is being financially comfortable enough to live the life you want to live. Emotionally, yes, that's long gone now. It's in the past. It raises itself occasionally. Even coming on this program was a decision that I had to decide whether I should share this with everybody, but I felt it was important to do so.
So just tell us what you've learnt from all of this.
Never give up is very important. No matter what life throws at you, you can't afford to let it get you down. In the end, the thing that'll keep you going is you and nothing else. You have to have confidence that if you believe in what you can do, you've got to get have a go. I've met people that have had businesses that have been extremely successful, but they locked themselves into believing that that business can't function without them. And they end up never retiring, but they dream of it. They think of getting their caravan and hooking it on the new four-wheel drive and one day going around Australia and seeing it. And then when they get to old age and they finally decide to do it, they don't make it. They find they're no longer physically fit enough. They get out there and they turn up in some remote, beautiful part of Kimberley or whatever, and then when they get there, they can't walk up the track to go and see the beautiful view that they've dreamed of doing for 30 years, and then they finally get there, they can't do it. So the important thing is to grab the bull by the horns at any stage of life and give it a shake. Life is like that.
Paul, we're going to bring you back into it at this point. Did being dropped as captain of the Socceroos change your outlook?
Absolutely. Yeah, never take anything for granted.
What was that like for you?
Wow. I'd sat on the bench, had been substituted, but to not even start a game, it was humiliating. So, I sat there and watched that game in Edmonton, and then we came back to Sydney for the second game. But in between times, I thought, working hard has not really got me anywhere. I'm just going to ask the assistant coach what I'm doing wrong. And he told me, he said, basically what you're doing is you're getting the ball, but then you're starting to think about what you're going to do with it after you get it. So your enthusiasm's there, but you're not thinking about what you're going to do before you get the ball. So I worked on that for the next couple of days. And I got dropped for the second game against Canada. We're talking World Cup qualified. So now we're in this country and I'm the only Socceroo captain ever to be dropped. Fortunately for me, the coach said, look, I want you to go on for the last 15 minutes. And that was my moment, right? So for 15 minutes, I touched every blade of grass on that ground. We went into extra time. I was still on the ground, still making lots of tackle, being enthusiastic. And then it came to a penalty shootout, right? Which is quite nerve-wracking at the Sydney Football Stadium, 45,000 people, penalty shootout. And we hadn't done any practice. So the coach said, right, who's taken the first one? And I went, me. And then I thought, you idiot, what have you done? This is a World Cup qualifier. You've just been dropped for two games. But that was the moment, I guess, I learned that life lesson that, you know what, it's all gone wrong and it's embarrassing, but, hey, step up. You're the Socceroo captain for very good reasons. And that was that, I don't know, setting an example. And I took the first penalty.
Let's take a look.
Paul Wade. And well taken.
Amazing stuff.
So can you lip read? You know, exactly. I got a phone call from my mum. You see you swearing on the television again?
So there you were, converting a shootout in a huge World Cup qualifier. How did you feel then?
I think it was that moment when I said, I'll take it. That was the defining moment. The walk from the halfway line to the penalty spot. It could have been 10 kilometres because the whole time you're thinking, right, which way am I going to go? Which way is he thinking I'm going to go? What's going to happen if I miss this? There are so many things that go through your mind. But what I did do is I put the ball down on the penalty spot and I looked in that corner. And then I looked at the ball and I looked at that corner. And I knew he was looking at me because he was thinking, he's going to kick it the other way. Well, I kicked it right in that corner. So the walk back for me was, as you can see with that fist punch there, that was wow. And from that day on, I got my shirt back. And the next game for the Socceroos, we played against Argentina and I marked Diego Maradona. That was my moment that I went, yes, Paul Wade is back to what he was. But it was just, wow, mind-blowing.
For you, Jane, obviously you had that failure the first time around with the business. What did you learn from that that you were able to take into the next business?
Yeah, so from the first business, well, not only did I learn a valuable lesson in failure in that it's not the end of the world, I learned that, we as humans are much tougher than we think and we can bounce back. And but, you know, I learned so much more about business. I think at the end of the day, it's funny, I have a degree in commerce, but the money that I lost in that business and the less than 1 year spent on that business was the best possible, you know, business course, crash course I could have done.
I've got to ask you about your parents.
Yeah.
When did you finally get the courage to fess up and tell them that your first business had failed? And in fact, you didn't have that corporate job.
So it actually took me
almost 2 years. And so, I mean, I don't know, maybe my parents are a bit gullible, but you could say. So after 6 months, I moved into my... my boyfriend moved down from Brisbane to Sydney, so he got his first corporate job, rented his first apartment, and then I just showed up. Like, we never had a let's move in together talk. I just showed up because so I can drop the parent charade. And so that was great. And then so at that point, we were getting close to $1 million a month, and, you know, I had a warehouse team of 20, 30 people, and it was then I was like, okay, you know what? I can see all the stock sitting there. I'm like, worst case scenario, I can sell that stock and I'll be okay. It's time to tell the parents. So I took them out to dinner. I took them out somewhere iconic, the Centrepoint Tower restaurant, and I told them I've paid off your mortgage, I bought you a car.
Amazing.
Don't get angry. I quit my job at EY because I told them that I was on... At first, I told them I was working, and then I told them I was on unpaid leave. They're pretty gullible. Anyway, considering they only have one child, they're pretty gullible. And they're like, wow, can't believe... And I told them I did that in July, and they're like, wow, can't believe you did that last year. That's very brave. And I was like, no, actually, I did it 2 years ago. And they're like, how did you have the balls to do that? And I said, well, you know, you've took the biggest risk of all. Like, they took the biggest risk of all to come here. And so, you know, they've got that in them, and that's where I got it from.
Tell us exactly what the business model is. What do you do?
So we sell women's fashion online, and the business is driven through really great marketing, really good social media, and really good product. It's very, you know, it's a very simple business model, and I think we've just done it really well. We have a really good team. Doing over $30 million. So everything that attributed to that failure, I've learned from it, and it's now what's driven the success of this showpo now.
Ron, how has your experience with Vault almost 40 years ago, how's that impacting on your work today?
I'm head of sculpture at the National Art School, and that's one of the great institutions where art is really taught well, and I'm too old to be retrained, so I'm going to keep that day job.
Well, you're working with students now. What are you teaching them about success and failure?
They need to be encouraged to develop their own sensibility and love and the position that they're in. And you need to reinforce that all the time.
Naji, do you think there's a stigma attached to failure?
Oh, definitely. And I think more so in Australia than anywhere else in the world. We should actually be celebrating failure. Imagine if we had a business model that celebrated failure. Imagine how more successful businesses would be if we, for example, in a room... Imagine if I was the boss, OK, let's say your business, our businesses, whatever. I'm going to celebrate the employee that comes up with an idea that and admits to it really fast that it's going to fail. OK, one, saving time. Two, saving money. OK, celebrate the person for owning up to the fact that it's not going to work. Move on. Let's go to the next thing. Then we might actually get somewhere. So, you know, like, let's celebrate failure.
We actually asked as an interview question, and I think when people can't answer, if anything, it shows a lack of self-awareness, which I think is a much bigger problem than having failed. So
yes, exactly.
I think it's really, but I think actually, funnily enough, when we were just talking before we started, I think we were quite nervous and saying, so how did you fail? Even though we're nowhere here to talk about failure, it was still like, so, so I think there's still that stigma, but I think things like this help people.
Dan, where do you stand on all of this?
I agree with everything. I have a new company and we were writing out our values, and one of the values was going to be fail fast, fail often, but we decided to change that to fail forward. And it's the idea that you can't move forward unless you fail, because if you're not failing, you're not trying new things. So.
Well, that is all we have time for here, but let's keep talking on Twitter and Facebook.